Welcome, everybody. Good afternoon. Welcome to the Winnipeg Committee for Safety. Today is May 16th. With me here today is Crystal Vandenbush, our coordinator. We have our members of the public service here that are helping us here with our technical stuff. And I also want to welcome the committee members. We'll start saying everyone's name. Muksi, is he here? I think Muksi's here. Abdi Odin, Jesse, Kathleen, Geary, Berkeley is unable to attend, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Narinder and Sarah and Tracy. So welcome, everybody. It's great to have you here. And I think, I don't know if I've missed anybody. Is there anybody here that I've missed? I think, is Greg McPherson here? No, not yet. And I think we have Staff Sergeant Brian Shapiro with us. I see his face, so perfect. Welcome. It's great to see everybody. First, we'll get started with somebody. First, I'm going to do the land acknowledgement. I just want to recognize that we're in Treaty 1 lands, the homeland of the Anishinaabe, Cree, and Dakota, and the birthplace of the Métis Nation. And can I ask someone move the minutes of the last meeting? Is that there? Kathleen? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Motion's carried. Okay. I think first up, we have somebody from Safe Speeds Winnipeg. Is Ian with us?
Hi, Ian. You can go ahead.
Welcome, Ian. Oh, we can't hear you. You're on mute. No. Still can't hear you.
Hi, Ian. We can't hear you.
No, not yet.
Can you hear me? Oh, is that better?
Yeah, that's perfect.
All right. I had to borrow one of my colleagues' classrooms. My students are eating in the classroom.
Okay.
All right. So I have a PowerPoint. Can I display it?
Yep.
Okay. Can you see that?
We don't have anything up yet. Oh, there it is. Yeah, we can see it now.
Okay. Well, thanks for having me out today. So Safe Speeds Winnipeg is a grassroots initiative to engage citizens about the impact of vehicle speed on people in Winnipeg neighborhoods. We uphold mobility as a human right in all the ways people move within our city. We value the safety of all Winnipeg's residents. We are urging the City of Winnipeg to amend the speed limit bylaw to enforce a default speed of 30 kilometers an hour in all Winnipeg neighborhoods. So why have Safe Speeds? Safe Speeds promote healthy, thriving neighborhoods. Safe Speeds promote physical activity by helping people feel more comfortable using active modes of transportation. With Safe Speeds, children are more likely to play outside and commute actively to school. Older adults are more likely to use active modes of transportation in neighborhoods with Safe Speeds. Active neighborhoods promote social interaction and strengthen community life. Retail businesses thrive with more pedestrian traffic, and Safe Speeds lower transportation emissions, which is important considering the climate crisis that we're in at the moment. So the backseat generation. I'm a school teacher. I've taught for 15 years, and this isn't data I've collected, but anecdotally, I can tell you that the greatest concern the parents have sending their kids to school actively is vehicle danger. So according to a 2015 national survey from Parachute and FedEx Express Canada, 75% of parents are concerned about their children sharing the road with speeding cars and traffic, and only 28% of students in that survey were walking to school, which is a high number for a North American city. As you can see in the U.S., it's somewhere around 10% of kids going to school on foot or by bike. Sorry about all the background noise. We'll quiet down in a second. All the kids are going out for recess right now. The Pedestrian and Bicycle Information Center, in collaboration with SRTS, or I don't know who that is, experts from around the U.S. found that in 1969, 48% of U.S. children 5 to 14 were walking or biking to school. In 2009, that number was 13% of U.S. children. And they also found that the U.S. Department of Transportation has found that nationally in the U.S., 10 to 14% of car trips during morning rush hour are for school travel, which is a significant amount of our morning and afternoon rush hour traffic. So this screenshot here is from the 2021 Climate Reality Report. You folks had asked whether or not pedestrian safety had gone up or down in Winnipeg. I can't really tell you. Winnipeg and Manitoba don't keep good stats on that. So even though I've been working for 3 years now on safe speeds, that's not information that I have access to. But I can tell you from the data that this report included is that Winnipeg has a significant number, a higher number of injuries and deaths for every 100,000 people living in the city.
Just so you know, I think the slides should be moving and we're not seeing it. You're still on the speeds kind of logo.
Oh, sorry. Well, I have some great slides here. It's changing on my screen. I don't know what to, how to fix it.
Oh, that's okay. Just keep going.
I'm going to share my PowerPoint with you folks later on today. I tried sending it earlier and again today, but for some reason, we're having some technical difficulties here.
Yeah, no worries.
Can you hear me? It's quite loud in the classroom here. There's a lot of kids outside the classroom door. Can you at least hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Anyways, then I'll describe to you what's on my screen here. So for every 100,000 people in Winnipeg, we have 97.7 people who are seriously injured or killed by cars. The next city in Canada with injury rates is Calgary at 58.7. So we have almost double the number of people being seriously injured or killed by cars in Winnipeg than in Calgary. In Vancouver, the number is lower. It's 49.9 people per 100,000 being seriously injured or killed. Saskatoon is 46 and Edmonton is 42.3. So Winnipeg has a very serious issue with people being injured or killed by motor vehicles. And as I mentioned in an earlier slide that you folks aren't seeing, safe roads are required so that people living in cities feel safe seeking alternative forms of transportation, such as walking or cycling. And beyond the tragedy that comes with somebody being seriously injured or killed, there's the economic, social, and environmental costs. So if I get killed by a car on my way home from school today, I'll be leaving two orphans and my spouse and then everyone in the community that I teach with, because we've made a decision in Winnipeg to prioritize moving cars. Socially, road injuries can lead to death, and when they don't, they inflict intense psychological and physiological damage to individuals involved. I've spoken with more people than I can remember over the years that have been adversely affected by road violence when they've been hit by cars. And sometimes, you know, it can be just as severe having an injury as it could be to be killed, because your life can be altered forever. Are my slides moving? There he is. Oh, my whole computer seems to be frozen. You know what? My computer's frozen. So anyways, this is the outcome of the budget cuts to our school system. So I'll just keep going. And so reducing the number of people driving will make our city safer. I had a couple of pictures of St. Mary's Road and Lindale Drive. And those are neighborhoods that streets that are adjacent to my neighborhood. Coming in and out of Norwood Flats, where I live, it can be very challenging. There aren't very many good active transportation routes to leave the neighborhood. Phase one of the 2050 Winnipeg Transportation Master Plan found that 2 in 5 Winnipeggers say they drive more often than they'd like to, and that 62% say they don't bike as often as they'd like. So there's a latent demand for active transportation, but people aren't doing it because they don't feel safe doing it. I'm going to move on. So the United Nations and the World Health Organization's Street for Life campaign was launched in 2021. This is the sixth UN Global Road Safety Week, and they were calling on policymakers such as yourselves to act for low-speed streets worldwide, limiting speeds to 30 kilometers an hour where people walk, live, and play. They want us to join the Love 30 campaign and call for 30 kilometer hour speeds in Winnipeg. And according to the World Health Organization, speed has been identified as a key risk factor in road traffic injuries, influencing both the risk of a road crash, because when you're moving faster, it's harder to avoid objects, as well as the severity of injuries. If you're going fast, you're more likely to cause damage. The higher the speed of a vehicle, the shorter the time the driver has to stop and avoid the crash. The relationship between speed and injury severity is particularly critical for vulnerable road users, such as pedestrians and cyclists. For example, pedestrians have been shown to have a 90% chance of survival when struck by a car traveling at 30 kilometers an hour or below. And I'll note that that's for an adult. A child is shorter and smaller and is more likely to go under the bumper of a car and be run over than an adult is. And the type of vehicle is important too. If you get hit by a small hatchback with a low hood, an adult is likely to go up onto the hood and the impact will be absorbed by the hood of the car. Whereas if you're hit by a large pickup truck, you're likely to have all of your internal organs damaged because it's basically just a big flat wall that's going to hit you hard and knock you down to the ground and run you over. At 45 kilometers an hour, you have a 50% chance of surviving an impact. And again, the severity goes up with the type of vehicle that you are hit by. So there's a number of, I've lost track of the number of North American cities that have lowered their default speed limits already. There's quite a few, but in Toronto, Canada, where speeds have been reduced to 30 kilometers an hour, they found that road crashes fell by 28%. And that was moving from 40 kilometers an hour to 30, not 50 to 30. That was from 40 to 30. Which led to a reduction in serious and fatal injuries by 2/3. So by lowering the speed limit from 40 to 30, they reduced injuries by 2/3. And Colombia, Bogota, has included 30 kilometer hour zones and a package of measures in its speed management plan that have reduced traffic fatalities by 32%. And a study from London found that lower speed limits, in this case, 20 mile per hour zones, were associated with a 42% reduction in road casualties. Winnipeg's making some good steps in the direction of lowering speeds. Most recently, as I'm sure you're all aware, Winnipeg introduced the enhanced summer bike routes along 15 streets and with 30 kilometer hour speed limits. And anecdotally, from the time I've spent on Uville and Lyndale, which are both in my neighborhood, most drivers have slowed down. It's remarkable. And it looks weird because Lyndale Drive is a gigantic, wide street. So it doesn't look like a place the car should be going that speed. And I mean, that's part of the problem. We have speed problems on Lyndale because of its width. Anyways, I'm going to try and get back in here and see if I can stop sharing and you can see me. And maybe we could just chat. You can ask me questions. And I'll pass along my PowerPoint to you folks and any data that I can provide you with. Oh, wow. Look at that. 23 seconds. That's pretty good, eh?
Well,
I had a couple of videos to share. Street design is important. Education is important and enforcement is important along with these speeds. But lowering the default speed limit is the first step.
Okay, great.
Anyways, questions?
Thank you. I will, anybody that has questions, just kind of go ahead. We'll be polite. I can't necessarily see you all. I don't know if you're all on the screen, so just go ahead and ask any questions. Questions?
Ian, this is
yes.
Gaz, a citizen member. I appreciate your time today, and I thank you for your presentation.
You're welcome.
With you that safety is a major consideration, as is climate change and even our dependency on oil and all of this. being focused around the idea of speed and increasing safety at the same time. I find it to be very appealing. I'm caught by the diverse. I'm caught by the kind of change that I've seen or that you've mentioned. Like a 42% reduction in road casualties in London, where we know they have a very robust emergency medical system, and so you know, they've likely had this system in place a lot longer than they've had the change in speeds in place, and so I think that speaks quite loudly to the point that you've brought up. I find this to be fascinating, and I look forward to getting some more information on it so that we can be a little more informed and make the right suggestions moving forward. So thank you.
Absolutely. I might just add that the best place to find information is from the World Health Organization and the United Nations. They have, when I send out my PowerPoints, their websites are all included in it. That's where we've been getting our data, and we've been working with some national groups. I just recently met with Parachute Canada, and they're going to be going to federal ministers and provincial ministers to ask that the federal government and the provincial government also lead on reducing speeds in cities and towns all over Canada to 30 kilometers an hour. It's really the most appropriate speed we can have in any urban setting, not just in Winnipeg.
This is Narendra Mathur here. Thank you, Ian. For all this information that you're providing to us. I'm, however, going to not agree with a couple of things here, because what I'm seeing, what the data that you're giving is hypothetical, decided by World Health Organization or somebody else, what the benefits are. It is not specific to Winnipeg. I know in Winnipeg, our city has already put in safe zones around schools during the school time. That's been a big factor in reducing casualties. I don't see any data coming from you about that. What has the impact been on safety? Number one. Number two, whatever.
Can I answer each of your questions? Like, yeah, why don't you ask me and then I'll answer, and you ask me the next one?
Make a note. Let me just speak here, please.
Sure.
So that's the number one data that we'd like to see. Number two, the data that you're giving us is, again, like I said, hypothetical. The city is growing, the population is growing, the number of cars are increasing, and I'm sure the city is looking at even how the roads are improving. But your data may be speaking about casualties, the number-wise, it is going up. But in terms of percentage, we'd like to see what the difference is, whether these casualty rates are going up or they're going down per 100,000. Depending upon the time frame, like say 10 years over a period of time, with the current pace, unless and until any policymaker, unless and until they see these kind of specific information, specific to the city, specific to the neighborhoods, I doubt very much. This is my honest opinion that anybody will be able to take and make any kind of decision. This is not to say that we don't welcome suggestions from you, but maybe the direction would be the city has to institute a committee which will look into these things and see what benefit we can derive out of it before we can make a decision. That's my take.
Okay, let me see if I can address all of those. Sorry, I'm not in my own office here, so I don't have didn't have pencil and paper. But the first point you made was about school zones being reduced to 30, and it seems that you think this is a positive thing, correct?
Yes, of course.
Okay, so for the past 5 days, a number of my colleagues who are responsible for our school patrols have come to me and they've been frustrated because there's a number of crosswalks that they're responsible for near our school on residential roads where people are, where the speed limit isn't 30. The only place that we have a 30 kilometer an hour speed limit around our school is on Hampstead Street, which is right in front of the school. It's less than half a block. It's where people drop their kids off in cars. And then all of the kids that are walking to the school are having to interact with 50 kilometer an hour traffic because the speed limit's not low. So for providing a safe space for the children whose families have the privilege of owning a car. And we're basically, we've told all the kids whose families can't afford a car. I teach in an inner city school. So 80% of our families can't drive because they don't have the means to do it. And we're basically saying, you know, too bad. We're only going to keep the area safe for this small group of kids who have privilege and can be driven to school. Oh, hold on, I'm not finished. So I've had Keenly Side Street runs right in front of a Manitoba housing unit where I set up a community bike hub and I fix kids' bikes and community members' bikes. And over and over and over again, I'm hearing from the community that people are driving too fast and they're worried about letting their kids go out. And, you know, the result basically is that instead of letting kids go out and play like we should be doing, because we want our neighborhoods to be full of kids, one of the points of Safe Speeds and creating safety in our communities is that having eyes on the street, as Jane Jacobs has long espoused, is really important. And we don't have a lot of people out in our communities because people don't feel safe in them. I had one slide in my presentation from South Point where a pedestrian was struck by a vehicle and injured so badly that they had to be airlifted off of their street. And, you know, this is just somebody going out for a walk in their neighborhood. And frankly, you know, whether our numbers are going up or our numbers are going down, our injury and death rates for pedestrians and cycling are double what the next nearest Canadian city is at, which, in my opinion, is completely unethical. I send my kids to school on bikes, and I shouldn't be compromising and saying, you know, kids, you have to be really careful, and it's your responsibility for your safety. And if one of them is distracted because one of their friends is playing and they run out into the street and get struck by a vehicle that we are permitting to go too fast, you know, too bad, kid, you're badly injured or dead. But, you know, at least somebody saved a couple of seconds on their commute. So in my mind, that's not, you know, it's not fair. And then the...
Can I interject? What I see...
Absolutely.
Hold on a second, Narinder. Just want to let him finish. You had three questions.
So
he finishes.
So the last point was that you were saying this is a theoretical idea, and it absolutely isn't theoretical. It's been tried and tested all over the world. And that's why countries like Spain just adopted a default speed limit in all of their urban settings of 30 kilometers an hour. The city of Paris has chosen 30 kilometers an hour for every street, not just residential streets, but every street. The city of Minneapolis has chosen a 20 mile per hour default speed limit, and they have a number of arterial streets with higher speed limits. But cities are making these decisions not because it's theoretical or somebody thinks it's a good idea. It's because there's lots of hard evidence. And this is why I'm saying go to the World Health Organization, have a look what they say. You know, they've done the research. We don't need to do it again in Winnipeg. It's been done everywhere else. We know that this creates safety and that this will get people on our streets, which I imagine the safety committee would think is a good thing, because the more people we have out walking around and riding bikes, the less crime we have. That's a good thing, right?
You know, I would say that Ian's also operating at a serious disadvantage without having the slideshow and the other materials he expected to have with him. Do you mind if I ask another question here?
Should we let the other gentleman just follow up?
Yeah.
And I'll just let you folks know I have to get back to the classroom in 13 minutes.
Okay.
So when you hear a bell, you'll see me go.
Okay.
Again, just my distinct take on what you just said, Ian, is that you're talking about the specific neighborhood which you're aware of. And I can understand that there may be other areas, but I also know that there may be other areas which are not there. They are pretty safe. So what you are for one neighborhood may not apply to the other neighborhood. We have to have a study in Winnipeg, which are the neighborhoods which require this. You know, Vancouver. You talked about Vancouver. I lived in Vancouver. In Vancouver, all the only areas where there is 30 kilometer is just near the school zones. That's what we are just done. And my suggestion again is to let give the city some time. These 30 kilometer zones have been put around school zones. People are reducing, enforcement is going up, and if there are some casualties or whatever is happening, I understand what will happen. happen. Okay. No matter whatever amount of caution we put together, some casualty will happen. But the answer to that is
But we can't accept any casualties to happen. Because it's one of those casualties, Narendra, might be my son.
It's impossible.
I don't want my son to die walking to school.
Okay, so just a second, Narendra, hold on. There's other people that are in line to ask a question. I'm going to follow up, Narendra, on your last question, because Ian might, he's probably aware of this, but he might not be aware. The city of Winnipeg is looking at, they are doing a study. Right now, there's a pilot project going on with some streets for 30 kilometers. So the city of Winnipeg is diving into this and looking at it in the Winnipeg context. So there is a study that's happening right now. So just so you're aware of, you might not be aware of that, Narendra, that we are looking at this right now.
That's what I'm proposing.
Could I add to that, Cindy?
So sure.
The neighborhoods that have been selected, they haven't, requests for proposals have gone out, but they haven't selected companies to do it yet. But yeah. Burkevale is a neighborhood that's just west of Route 90 and north of the Assiniboine River near Assiniboine Park, but on the other side of the park. The community there has requested a 30 kilometer an hour speed limit, and they are one of the pilot neighborhoods. Tyndall Park is one of the neighborhoods that's being piloted. There's a neighborhood in St. Patel between St. Anne's and St. Mary's, just north of Bishop Grandin, that is going to be trialed. And then the last neighborhood that's being trialed is out at Pembina Highway and the Perimeter Highway, just west of Pembina and north of the Perimeter. It'll be trialed as well. So the trials are going to be for 30 kilometers an hour and 40 kilometers an hour. The city's decided to do both, but yeah. I will emphasize that good public policy is 30. So 40 is a compromise, and it's a compromise for people's safety. Yeah. Because I really need to stay like.
I tried to get Wolseley added to that for 30.
I
didn't win.
Yeah,
but we'll give it to Sarah now. She's got questions.
Okay. Sarah.
Hi, I just want to thank you for sharing all that information. I actually live on Warsaw Avenue, which was selected as one of the streets to be reduced to 30 about, I guess, almost a year ago. I do know that when Toronto implemented the decrease to 30, like their rates that I know Narendra was talking about decreased by 28%, and that was per 100,000 people. So I know that it works. I know that initially, my neighborhood really bristled against seeing it and was concerned that it was going to be a hazard for bicyclists and all sorts of things. But now that it's been long enough, everyone really does seem to appreciate it. I know that the street hockey kids on my street feel safer being able to get out of the way of cars because they know that they have time. And so I guess my concern is that because Winnipeg was really designed to be such a car city, by reducing all of their residential neighborhood streets to 30 or 40, whatever the pilot program sort of determines is best, are we concerned that the amount of investment we would have to put into the major arteries to try and compensate for people not being able to cut through the residential streets, which we obviously don't want them to do, are we worried that we're going to be able to make those investments in a way that is able to keep up with phasing that in?
Sure, I can answer that. So I'm glad you're enjoying the 30 can work. So as a person who rides a bike, I love it. I can ride without worrying about cars trying to zip around me, which makes me uncomfortable, especially when I have my kids with me. In terms of Winnipeg being designed as a car city, Winnipeg was designed as a walking and streetcar city until the Korean War. And then after the Korean War, we started developing the cul-de-sacs and the neighborhoods that that we know now out in the outer suburbs of the city. So within the core areas like Cindy's area or your area or my area in St. Boniface, very little has to be done. I mean, my street is narrow and it has the same speed limit as a wide arterial street just down the road. So both streets aren't designed for the same speed. Either the arterial road should be way faster or my street should be slower. And, you know, most people going 30 feels comfortable for my neighbors. They don't get their backs up when they do that. But if somebody drives 50 down my front street, I'll tell you, there'll be a few of the mums out there shaking their arms and other things at people going by, even though they're not breaking the speed limit. In terms of the increase of traffic on arterial routes, my friend and counselor Matt Allard put in a motion a couple of years ago asking the city to accept induced demand. And induced demand basically states that if you add a lane of traffic, you'll get more people driving. And the same thing applies if you take away some lanes of traffic. I'm seeing that right now. The Nairn is shut down at the Nairn overpass, and everybody coming out of Transcona to get downtown has had to adjust. So on day one, it was pandemonium around the intersection and it was gridlocked. And by Tuesday and Wednesday, things were back to normal because people found alternatives. They decided to travel at different times. They decided to take different routes. So by reducing the number of places that people can drive, we're increasing the places that people can commute in different ways. And I got to school this morning on an urban arrow with an electric assist, and I carried 200 pounds of tools and all my school things on it. So, and I was traveling at 30 kilometers an hour on my bicycle. Nobody in my neighborhood noticed me. If a kid had run out in front of me, I probably wouldn't have done much damage because I'm on a bicycle and I could react to it. So, you know, the hopes are, and Winnipeg has said that they want to get driving down to 50% mode share. So they want 50% of trips done in cars, and then the other 50% done by walking, biking, busing, and car sharing. So we shouldn't see any more driving right now. We're at 85%. As Winnipeg grows, we don't want to be adding lots of extra drivers to our roads. We can't afford to do that. As you all know, Winnipeg's roads are falling apart already. We want people taking the bus, walking, riding their bikes. We want more compact communities, and safe speeds works well into that. We want people to make those short trips to school on a bicycle or walking. We want people to be going to their corner stores. We want people to be more active in their communities. So that's a big element of what we're doing here. I hope that answers your question.
Great.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, well, seeing the time, Ian, I know you got to get back to school.
I can go right till the bell. I'll go right back to class and I'll let them read for a couple of minutes. Like,
for anybody else, any other questions? Yes?
So, thank you. One of the most popular programs that the committee has taken part in is the Please Slow Down signs that we've taken part in distributing. And I still see them, people bring them back out every year. I see them on public property, which is not where they're supposed to be. And I think this speaks to people's perception of their safety. And perception of safety and safety are inextricably linked. My perception of safety might be off in one area, but that perception may affect my actual safety in another or even in that same area. My question is about how we determine where the 30 kilometer speed limit goes. You said walk, live, and play is the focus, and that sounds fair to me because that's where it's required. But can you say a little more about that and how that's determined?
Absolutely. So basically, you know, this is going to take some time for the city to catch up. The city's really focused on building roads and not building active transportation facilities. So we would like to see residential roads at 30 kilometers an hour, and roads that have separated infrastructure could have higher speeds. So if I'm leaving my neighborhood, you know, I leave my house, I'm taking all the residential streets until I get to St. Mary's Road. And then on St. Mary's Road, there's a dedicated bike lane that I can take my kids on to get where I need to go. And then when I get to the neighborhood I'm arriving at, there's no longer a dedicated bike route, there's no separation, and now the speeds are back down to 30. So if you go to any city with high cycling rates in Europe, you'll find that areas with higher speeds have the separation, in areas with no separation where people walking and biking and driving mix, the speeds are lower, which is exactly what we're calling for. And just make a note about the please don't slow down signs that you folks might find interesting, but Councillor Edie made a presentation in July of 2020 at the council meeting. You can find it on YouTube. If you send me an email, I'll send you the link and the timestamp so you can see it. But he made a point saying that he was irritated that people were calling for speed studies on residential streets, and the studies were being done and the city found that people were going on average 42 kilometers an hour, for example. And he said, why are people complaining about people going 42 kilometers an hour? And Ross is a buddy of mine. So I called him up and we went out and we talked about it. And I said, Ross, people are complaining about people going 42 kilometers an hour because they don't feel safe when someone goes 42 kilometers an hour on their street. They're telling you that they want a lower speed. So, you know, if you folks, another quick anecdote, Councillor Berwadi put out a poll last year, or maybe it was the year before, on people's appetite for safe speeds, and it found that there wasn't a majority of people that wanted it. But what it did find out, which I thought was interesting, was that in those post-Korean or pre-Korean War neighborhoods, the ones in the center of our city, that's where it's popular. And they also found that it's very popular with people who have children. So, you know, it's not going to be popular with the masses, but it's going to be popular with people who really matter, people with kids. I mean, these are the most vulnerable people in our society, and we need to do a better job of making our neighborhoods accessible to them. I have to go, but I'm going to say I'm probably one of the most active transportation advocates in Winnipeg, not the most, but I'm up there. I don't feel safe letting my kids walk or bike to school. And my kids take the bus, and I'm not sure what I'm going to do when my 10-year-old turns 12, because they have to go through Central St. Boniface, and people drive way too fast through there. So my kids can't ride their bike to school in their neighborhood because we don't have a safe space for them to go. And it drives me, it just makes me really sad. I hope that we can fix this sooner than later. I don't think we should study something that we know is the right thing to do any longer. We should just do it.
Okay, well, Ian,
I could come back and talk again. I could deliver my PowerPoint again another time. I'm sorry,
If you can send us the PowerPoint so we can give it to everybody, that would be great. And we'll distribute it.
You bet.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me. If you have any other questions, send me an email. I'll be happy to answer them that way.
Okay, thank you. Have a great day.
Thanks so much. Have a great day.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay, so now up on the agenda is a verbal report from the chairperson. Okay, so that's my report. So I just wanted to update the committee on a couple of things that I'm really excited about. The first is the affordable housing now. For the first time, and this is something I've been pushing forward for since I've become elected, for the first time, the city of Winnipeg has an affordable housing strategy. So I'm very, very excited. It's it's one of my projects I've been working on. So I'm very happy to finally see this day. So what that means is it's going to be about $78 million of housing. And what's really exciting about it is that we're doing a TIF program, which is a tax incremental financing. I know that's probably, it's kind of giving our taxes for free for affordable housing projects is kind of a simpler way of saying it. But for non-for-profits, they will have 25 years of tax-free savings. And then for other developers inside Winnipeg that aren't in the downtown, it'll be 15 years. And for those that are in the downtown, 25 years. So it's really great investment. And we're really hoping to get spur a lot of affordable housing development, and also that deep affordable housing and that transitional housing. So there's also $2 million that's going to go into helping support some of that traditional housing that just needs a little bit. They'll get the TIF, and they'll also get this about $250,000 just to help with the permits and all that kind of stuff, those costing. So it's really exciting. I think that that's something in terms of safety. I think we all know that we have a housing crisis here, especially in affordable housing. And most importantly, what I like to say is transitional and supportive housing, which I think is critical. And so the city will be working with CMHC, Canada Mortgaging, and they're going to be helping support this program. So very excited that this is happening. That's along with that's also with the rapid housing. So there could be some really great financial gains for people that are wanting to do affordable housing. So that's a very exciting thing. I wanted to let you know that the city of Winnipeg, first ever. Yay, it's exciting. So the downtown recovery, we're working with the downtown biz, all the different biz zones kind of within the downtown. And there's been money put into making sure that we're investing into the downtown. So areas like Air Canada Park that needs to be transitioned, we're looking at that space and how we can make it a space for everybody, a more equitable space, and clean things up a bit downtown, making sure that we have festivals, and you know, really trying to get people back working downtown. Some of the issues that we're seeing is the fact that, you know, we still don't have enough people coming back to downtown. So we're still not seeing those numbers of people. A lot of people are working remotely still. And, you know, that might be the new norm. So we're really struggling. So we want to make sure we get people back downtown, supporting our local businesses, you know, going to the restaurants, shopping in the malls and all that kind of stuff. So that's something that we're working on. And of course, just to go with Safe Speeds Winnipeg, just because that was the topic today. In my ward, I was actually able to get the 30 zone on Wolseley, and we have a new one, Ruby Banning. And so that's going to be kind of a dedicated bike route. So it'll be shared with the car, but it'll be down to 30. So that's kind of something that's new, exciting this year. And again, they are working on a pilot project, and it is going to be looking at 40 and 30. I think the city knows that we do got to reduce the speeds. And I think there's just an argument on what those speeds should be. And yeah, I think that's it for my report. So any questions to me? I know that some of you I haven't been able to connect with yet. We don't know each other that well. And some of you are very familiar with me. So, but feel free to, if you have questions afterwards, feel free to connect with me and I'll try to respond to any of the questions that you might have. Okay, now we'll move on then to, can I have somebody move my verbal report? Okay, Sarah, all in favor? Motion's carried. Okay, now we're moving on to the committee coordinator's report.
Hi, everyone. Just recognizing the time. I know that there's a few people that need to leave by 1 o'clock, so I'm going to race through my verbal update real quick. So I, as you know, I sit on the Vehicle for Hire Advisory Committee, and there's just two little updates with that I wanted to share with you. The Vehicle for Hire annual report passed it at last council's meeting. And of particular concern with this report was the code of conduct for taxi cab drivers. This has passed, and so this will serve to professionalize the industry. And there is a piece in there about a potential fine of up to $250 for taxi cab drivers who have been found to sexually harass passengers. And so if you haven't been made aware or been paying attention to sort of what's led up to this, on April 6th, there was a swath of delegations, women and two men, who came to present to the Public Works Committee about their experiences of being sexually harassed and targeted for sexual violence in taxi cabs. And so I'm thankful that this has passed, that there are accountability mechanisms in place now for if taxi drivers choose to engage in that behavior. So that is definitely a step in the right direction. The second thing about Vehicle for Hire, last week they launched the wheelchair accessible the wheelchair accessible vehicle. It's a centralized booking service now, so people can book online via an app or by calling. And what's important about this is that they're able now to book their wheelchair accessible vehicles on demand. My understanding is that they weren't able to do it on demand before. So as you can imagine, it makes participating in your community really challenging when you have to book your transportation days in advance sometimes. So that's really exciting that has come to fruition. The third piece is just about the Who Do I Call card. So I don't know what exactly has happened, but there's a big demand for them lately. And so I guess because they're out there more now, more people are seeing them. And so I've been getting a significant amount of requests from library branches, from some provincial departments, and then from school divisions as well. So I think what I'm going to do is print off a bunch of a bulk amount and then give them to the school divisions to disperse, because it will probably make my life a little bit easier that way. But it's good to see that the cards are useful. They're obviously meeting a need out there. So just wanted to update you on that. In terms of our work with the Canadian Municipal Network on Crime Prevention, some of the DIY consultations, the data has come back. So from Turning Leaf, I know Barclay isn't with us today, but thank you to Barclay and his staff for getting that into us quite quickly. North End Women's Center has also provided the data, so thank you to them, as well as Rainbow Resource Center. ERCOM wasn't able to complete their DIY consultation, and so just moving down the list of the organizations that you guys have identified, I've reached out to Manitoba START to see if they're willing to help us out with the consultation. So I'll keep you posted on that. The last thing for my update is just in regards to the Winnipeg Safe City Initiative. So for the senior members of the committee are well aware that the Winnipeg Safe City Initiative didn't have any funding for a number of years up until late 2021. And because of the generosity of this committee, allocating a portion of its budget towards the Safe City Initiative, we were able, Councillor Gilroy and I were able to continue the Safe City Initiative. And now that the initiative has its own funding, it will be considered separate from this committee from now on. Because Councillor Gilroy and I are both still on that file, of course we can provide updates, but just wanted to thank the senior members of this committee in particular, Tracy, Narendra, Gaz, and Kathleen, and Carrie, and Jaydeep, who are no longer on the committee, but you kept it alive. You kept it alive with what little, budget you could share. And so that's appreciated, and it helped get it to where it is today. So thank you for that. That's my verbal update. Can someone move a motion to receive as information?
Okay, Honor in there. All in favor? Motion's carried. Okay, now we're on to the budget review of honorarium expenditure. Did you do that?
I have that as the fifth item.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Okay, it's extension of contract?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, awesome. Thank you. So extension of contract for CMNCP. So a bit of background context. At the beginning of the strategic planning process, the committee was tasked with identifying a few priority populations. And so the purpose of this is to consult with populations to get their feedback about their experience with community safety. And so seven priority groups were identified, and it was challenging to narrow down who to pick from, right? Because if we pick two or three, then we're necessarily excluding other people. And the reality is that the feedback from each of the groups is valuable. And so the committee has decided to stick with all of the seven groups that were identified. So this is related to the extension of the contract because there are more consultations than we had originally planned and that were outlined in the proposal. As well, the consultations are taking longer than expected to come in. And so it will require further data analysis. So what I'm suggesting to you as committee members is that the contract for CMNCP be extended to play it safe, to extend it to September of 2022. I do expect that the work will be completed before then, but just to play it safe, September 2022, and then with an increase of $1,060 to do that extra work. So this is well within our budget. I'm going to talk about the budget in a minute, but that's my proposal to the committee members. Thoughts, concerns?
Reasonable, I agree.
Okay, is that a motion then, Narinder? Do you want to make a motion?
Okay. Yeah, I propose to extend the contract as suggested.
Okay, all in favor? Motion's carried. All right.
Okay. Awesome.
Now we're on to the 2022 budget review of honorarium.
Right. So just wanted to give a quick update about where we're at with the budget. So what we have outstanding and left to spend of the year is $11,812.50. I wanted to just put on the record that part of the work with the community consultations is that we will be providing honorariums for the participants in the form of $10 gift cards. We had one group that asked if we would be able to provide cash, and we're not able to do so. So $10 gift cards, I'm working with the community organizations so that they can determine, you know, if it's a Tim Hortons gift card or Sobeys or whatever suits kind of the population best. And so if we've got seven groups times 12, $10 each would be $840 in total for the honorariums, a small token of appreciation for the participants who are giving us valuable feedback related to community safety. So I'm proposing to the committee, hoping that this can be approved today to spend that funding to show our token of appreciation for the participants. Can someone move a motion to approve this?
I'll move that we approve that, yeah. Yes.
Okay, Gaz, all in favor?
Yep.
Yeah, all favor.
Motion's carried.
Great. Thank you. Okay. Last update from me. Sorry, counselor. I'm just recognizing the time and we're on a roll. So I would like to see this committee become a signatory of the Indigenous Accord. So a bit of background about the Indigenous Accord, in case you're not familiar, it's a tool that has been adopted by the City of Winnipeg since 2017. And really the goal is to make our city a better place to live based on mutual respect, equal opportunity, and hope, and in the spirit of reconciliation. So becoming a signatory partner involves a group such as ourselves setting a self-identified goal each year along with a corresponding plan of action. And this is to be guided by the vision of the Accord, as well as to involve one or more pieces of the TRC's call to action and or MMIWG 2S plus calls for justice. And so once we've identified our goal statement and the plan of action, it will be submitted to the Indigenous Relations Division, and partners will also attend regular Accord meetings. So I would be doing that on your behalf. And at the end of each annual cycle in May, the partners will complete a briefing report that will be submitted to council. So what I like about this is that there's actually accountability mechanisms in place. And I think that the timing of this works out quite well because we are in the process of doing the strategic plan. So it would be useful, I think, to bake in to the plan how we could possibly address the calls for justice. So in terms of becoming a signatory, there's an annual ceremony that will take place on Tuesday, June 28th from 9 to noon at the Udina Circle at the Forks. I would invite all of the committee members, if you can attend, that would be appreciated. Either Councillor Gilroy or myself will be attending as your representatives if you decide that this is something that we should do. We would have to come up with a goal statement as a group prior to June 10th, and that is actually shared at the Accord ceremony and is read aloud at the ceremony. So I'm proposing that we bake this into our strategic plan. It's really important work. And like I said, there's accountability mechanisms in place. So that's always helpful as well. Any questions or concerns on this item?
No.
Seeing none, is someone willing to move a motion that we sign on to the Indigenous Accord?
Gaz, all in favor? Motion's carried.
Awesome.
Okay,
thank you.
So now I don't think Moxie's here, is he? Is Moxie here? Moxie? Okay.
He's gone?
Okay. What about somebody from Community Services? Like Greg McPherson? Yeah. Hi, Greg.
Hi, good afternoon, Counselor. It's nice to see you. Thanks, everybody. I'm going to be quick. I understand we only have a few minutes left for a lot of us. So I have one kind of related announcement that I can offer. We are delighted to announce that tomorrow there'll be a launch event celebrating the newly built public washroom facility at 715 Main Street. So our division's been working hand in hand with a number of the other departments to launch this. This is on the west side of Circle of Life Thunderbird House, right down at the corner of Main and Higgins. And the facility will be open probably at the end of the month, but tomorrow's launch will be celebrating that we're getting really close. It's going to be known as a Wigamig, which is a dignified and kind of polite Ojibwe word for washroom. And we've identified that peer support services are really important to have on site just for safety and for everybody's well-being. So we're pleased to announce that Mama Wichita Center has signed on to provide these services for the next couple of years. And the building will be open 10 hours per day, 7 days a week at a minimum. And we're hoping to do some more fundraising to extend those hours. But for the time being, probably by the end of May, you'll be able to use the washroom there 10 hours a day. And it's exciting. It's the first public washroom facility that's been opened by the city of Winnipeg in a few decades. So we're really excited about that and gearing up for tomorrow's launch event. So other than that, I've been working on the redraft and revision of the 2008 Live Safe crime prevention policy. And Councillor Gilroy will know about this, that we're trying to incorporate the United Nations Safer Cities movement and a number of other pre-existing council directives to make the new policy, which will be known as Safe City by Design, a more modern and wide-reaching document, policy for our city. So yeah, exciting times ahead, and I'll have more to report on that at the next meeting, I'm sure. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Any questions? Well, okay, seeing no questions, somebody want to move Greg's report? Okay, Narinder, all in favor? Motion's carried. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Greg. Okay, so now we're on to the Winnipeg Police Service. Oh, did he have to leave? Still, oh, there he is. He's still here. Making it to the very end, eh?
Right to the end, yes. We're waiting on confirmation of funding to relaunch the Neighborhood Watch Program.
Oh, okay.
That should be coming imminently, and then we'll be rolling that back out into the community with a couple of community events, community engagement events in each district that we have. So we'll be hosting one session per district, and we're going to hope to do that twice a year to roll that program back out so people are aware. But we're going to also include other things like all valuables removed. Online reporting, so there'll be more information going out as well. So we're going to try to improve our two-way communication with people involved in that program.
That's really exciting. Can we get to know when it is? Because we can help share that data. We can help.
When I get confirmation, I will send you something. But I'm still waiting. Unofficially, yes, but I can't go further. So you're all sworn to secrecy. Thank you very much for doing that. But yeah, we're waiting to hear that. And then we will we'll let the city know for sure. We'll let you know for sure personally to make sure your office is advised. A number of other councillors are interested in the program. There's been a lot of requests. We have a lot of people that are on our distribution email list that are waiting for the program to come back. And it'll be an exciting relaunch for our service to try to become more engaged and you know, we're hoping that the app can be utilized to do push notifications to let people know what's going on in the communities. So
that's exciting. Any questions? No. Did you have any more updates? Sorry.
No, I think that's what I have for now. I have somebody waiting at my door for another meeting that was supposed to come minutes ago. So I will have to excuse myself. Thank you.
Fair enough. I'm sure we'll have more time next time. So thank you very much, everybody. Can do somebody move to adjourn? Okay, Sarah, all in favor? Motion's carried. Perfect. Thanks, everybody. Have a great afternoon.
Bye, everybody.